All right,
Yeah.
awesome. So, welcome back to the second episode of the podcast. Today we have the wonderful Life Spiller 79 with us, and he has definitely a great channel. And thanks for checking out the episode of the podcast. And we got a couple topics here, so Life Spiller, what can you tell us about your channel?
Well, if you haven't seen it yet, or if this is your first time hearing about my channel, pretty much my channel consists of doing like retro stuff. I really like talking about retro video games. I am current gen as far as like in the know, and I have systems and stuff like that associated with that. But I really have a passion and a deep love for that. And so pretty much my channel consists of talking about retro stuff. And I also I've moved more into the realm of doing like vlogs and just hypothetical questions and stuff like that. And then also, let's see, what else did I do? Reviews, reviews, vlogs, podcasts every now and then. I haven't been much on those podcasts because I've been on other people's podcasts, video responses and stuff like that. The typical stuff that allows you to be a part of the gaming community. But yeah, my big passion is talking about retro video games. So, and I'm also very transparent about my life as well. So yeah. So yeah, that's, hold on a second here. But yeah, that's pretty much what my channel consists of.
Yeah, and you do some pretty good videos. And as for my own channel, that's pretty much what I do. I try to come up with like experiments that I can do, but yeah, that's pretty much the kind of direction I go in. I'm also a very big fan of the retro gaming scene as well.
Yeah, I try to tell people all the time is that don't just do one type of video, because that's the thing. I think a lot of people, when they first start their channel, they don't know which direction to go, so they either try to emulate what they already see with one of the YouTubers that they're already following, so then they don't never really get into their own. And that's what I did. I was trying to stand out a little bit, because, you know, like a lot of these gaming channels that started out, they all started out with pickup videos or game find videos. And most channels, they end up getting stuck in this terrible place where that's all they have to offer. Now, if it's something that generates a nice audience for you or something like that, that's great. Then you can keep doing that. But I myself, I knew that realistically, it just became too expensive to keep that going. So I started thinking to myself, I said, what can I do besides, you know, just pickup videos? I was like, well, let me start trying to get into the realm of doing news type videos or just talking about current stuff going on. But then about a year and a half ago, I just moved into the realm of doing vlogs and just, like I said, the hypothetical questions, and still do the video responses and stuff like that. But yeah, man, I think each channel is its own definition. So you really just have to define yourself and try to stand out amongst the others. That's the biggest thing that I always try to tell people, is that don't get so caught up in the little stuff, because then it'll get you distracted. But yeah, man, that's pretty much what the channel consists of for me anyway. My channel, anyway.
Yeah, and that's some really good advice right there, because, it's always important to be honest, unless you're playing a character or if you're just trying to do, like, some parody type things. Yeah, I really can't add much more to that, because that's definitely some really good advice there. And with my own channel...
Yeah, so I,
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah, go ahead. No, you're good.
With my own channel, when I first started out, I had wanted to be like the angry video game nerd. This is such a cliche thing, but I was going to put my own spin on it. And that style has just been done and done and done. And so I thought, okay, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to do my own thing. So I was working on doing some kind of editorials and analysis kind of reviews on a lot of different games that I really liked, and I had started up the channel, and like for 3 months I did nothing but update videos, like, okay, the review's gonna be this month, nope, it's gonna be next month. And when I finally put it out, you know, I was so happy that I got something out, but I was like, man, this is pretty bad. So over time, you definitely really improve. You figure out what with the writing and, you know, the more off-the-cuff stuff and just getting in front of the camera and everything. It's a really great process, and I think perseverance plays a lot into that because, you know, if you feel like, oh, this is terrible, I couldn't watch this, and then just stop, well, you can't get better. You gotta keep on going, and you gotta keep... and you got to keep making videos or you'll never improve. I think that's just how life is in general. With life, you have to keep on going and learn from what you've done and, you know, just make things improve as you go on.
Oh, yeah. That's why I always tell people. I said, man, I keep all those videos up, even the cringy videos where it's just like, man, this was really bad. Because if you look at that's, I guess it's just a testament of everything that you've already been through. And like you said, it's really, as you go, you learn how to do this better. How can I make this look better? How can I make this sound better? What visuals can I use? Because I didn't start using visuals. You know, like, some of these dudes crack me up because they just now coming into YouTube, and they immediately get to use all the things that I couldn't even use when I first started my channel. And I started my channel like 4 years ago. So back then, we really didn't have all this great, great software to work with, you know, not easily utilized. So I couldn't put in, like, the transition of video overlays and stuff like that, graphics and stuff like that, names, all that words. All those things weren't even able to be put into those videos. So you just kind of, you had to work with what you had. But like you're saying, yeah, it's really more so just learning as you go. And that's... And being a one-man show, which is pretty much what I've been, I've had to learn things as I go. And like you said, I've done the same thing myself. I've watched plenty of tutorials. And, you know, I have to say that, yeah, I've watched, if anybody's style that I tried to press towards on my channel was Happy Console Gamer, just because of the way he would deliver, how much he was passionate about certain games and stuff like that, when he would do like a story about a video game and relations to his own life and what he was experiencing at that time. So those things kind of stood out for me. And yeah, those reviews, yeah, people don't know how long it takes to do a review. It's not only just, like you said, coming up with the writing, the concept, the idea, putting all those things together, then getting the gameplay, getting all the stuff together. So over time, I've learned how to wrap it up, kind of get to the point, but still be able to make a point to talk about the video game, give people an idea or a sense of what I experienced and what I actually like from the video game. But yeah, reviews, I have to say the review videos, they usually take the longest. They take longer than vlogs because vlogs, those are usually off the cuff. And I'm actually in the process of working with a few other channels, doing some collabs and stuff like that. I've actually been doing a collab with Gaming for Days on his podcast, and then I'm also in the process of working with another YouTuber. Him and I, we're trying to put a script together, which is going to be a different experience for me because I haven't done scripts. I typically don't do scripts. I do bullet points and stuff like that just to stay on course, and now I'm using a lot of other things just to stay on time. But yeah, man, I really haven't got into doing the script thing, so now I'm going to have to learn how to do that. So what actually got you into video games?
Well, I've been... See, here's the thing. I don't really remember, because when I was 2 years old, that's the furthest back I can remember, and I was playing video games, and some of my earliest memories are playing video games. You know, I played games on the PS1, and, you know, since the PS2 was just kind of coming out, then I was playing a lot of games on the PS2 because, you know, I'm a younger kind of guy in this whole YouTube scene, so I played a lot of stuff like that, you know, GameCube, Dreamcast. I freaking love the Dreamcast. You know, Seaman, that game's hilarious. Sonic Adventure, Crazy Taxi.
Yeah.
I'm actually working on a, you know, a review of all the Crazy Taxi games. I'm, you know, analyzing them and stuff. I've been writing down so many notes, having a blast doing that. But, yeah, so it was around that time, and I don't know, I just always grew up with systems around because, you know, my dad was a huge gamer. He'd been playing since the Atari days and, you know, in the arcades and everything. And my brother was a big fan of it at the time, too. So I just grew up around it, and I grew a passion for it. And, you know, a lot of the time, video games have been able to help me escape reality. That's one of the things that I absolutely loved about it, because, you know, there have been days, there have been good days, there have been bad days, and then, you know, there have been days where I just kind of want to shut everybody out and just kind of do my own thing, because I love being alone. So, you know, having the video games and everything, I just get to be alone in that world and experience those characters and everything. And I don't know, it's just something that I just became very passionate about because it was there. And over time I grew a bigger love for it. So I don't know, it's just something that I've always grown up with.
That's funny. Yeah, because I was probably, man, you make me sound old, because that definitely when I started playing around that time of Atari myself. Let's see, you can go back to like the Atari 2600. And so I think that was in the 80s, something like that. So I've been playing ever since then. But yeah, mine was just a slow growth, really. I actually got into video games when I was around 6-7 years old, something like that. So yeah, I've been playing since then, and I started out with the Atari 2600, and I just went from there. Now, there were a few systems that I actually ended up missing out on. Like, I did miss out on the PS1, only because I had the Nintendo 64. I got it day one. So when the PlayStation 1 came out, it was like $300, so I didn't even get it. I got the N64, and so when I got the N64, I kind of skipped over that. I've managed to play some of the games over the years. Like, I built up a pretty decent collection for the PlayStation 1. Good thing is that you can actually go back and play those on your PlayStation 2 or PlayStation 3, which I have in my collection. So that's pretty much where mine came from. But yeah, I know what you're talking about with the escape. That pretty much sounds like my high school days. That's how it was. Spent a lot of time alone trying to get an understanding of who I was as a person, or who I am as a person even now. You eventually start to grow out of that. You know, you start to learn a little bit more about yourself and how you can handle yourself in certain situations and stuff like that. But yeah, definitely, I have to say I spent a majority of a lot of time in my teen years by myself. I know that. I mean, I had relationships and all that, but a big percentage of that just because I just my preference at that time anyway, so. Yeah,
and I'm in my teen years right now, so yeah, I can definitely relate to that. I definitely spend a lot of time by myself, just doing whatever, writing or just thinking in general. Like, you know, a lot of people think it's kind of weird, but I just like to sit around and just think by myself. That's my comfort zone, which I know to a lot of people they don't really understand that. You know, who've told me, kind of come out of your shell and all this other stuff, which, you know, I have some traits of an extrovert, and I have some traits of an introvert, but usually I have a lot of introvert traits. The only, like, I was looking at the traits for an extrovert, and almost all of them didn't fit me, except for the changing in pitch thing. That's the only thing that I could find out of any of them, so I guess I'd be an ambivert. I don't know. It's confusing to me.
Yeah, it's a combination. Yeah, it's a combination of the two. I know I'm definitely an introvert. I always preferred that alone time. It's just never, it was never a question for me. I always knew that, like, I didn't know what an introvert was early on. Like, in my teen years, I didn't know what that was. I just knew that I had a preference of spending more time by myself than I did with other people. Like, I didn't need, like, some people have that void where they need to be around other people, and I just never felt that. Like, I never felt that void in my life. Like, oh, no, I don't hang around with all these people all the time. It was just like, I felt like I was, like you're saying, I felt like I was in more of a creative space to be able to think about a lot of things, be able to put a lot of things together. I already had planned out my future and everything. Like, I knew my first year in high school, when my freshman year, I already knew what I wanted to do with my life. I knew I wanted to work in computers. I didn't really have a lot of questions about it. So it was just like always kind of there. I just was always planning my next move. Where do I want to go next for my life? What do I want to do these next few years? Because high school was just going to be a snap, and it's going to be over, and it's going to be gone. And then what are we going to do with our lives? But yeah, I remember all the name being called and stuff like that, being weird and all that, because people didn't understand. I think the whole thing back then versus now, people are starting to understand a little bit more about defining people's personality traits and understanding who you are. Like, now, especially with YouTube helped out tremendously explaining things to a lot of people who just don't get, like, even now, a lot of my family is just now coming to the realization that I'm an introvert, and now they're, some of them even come to the point where they understand who they are. They're like, you know what, that's actually me. I'm actually an introvert. And like, I know that I can spend a lot more time by myself than with tons of people. It's just, it's always been that way. Like, I spend too much time with a bunch of people, and then eventually, like, if I'm at a party, I'll just walk away. After so many hours, I'm like, okay, I got to go chill out and do my own thing. But I think that's why I spent so much time with video games. And, you know, in a lot of my videos, I talked about that. My real life that I was going through was just so chaotic, and there was just so much that I was going through. So it was really, it was an escape. That's pretty much helped me out a lot. But yeah, man, so what are you currently playing?
Well, before I get to that, I was just going to say that, I think, you know, you talking about, your life with video games, is something that really drew me to your channel when I found it from Happy Console Gamer. And going back to him, I noticed that both of your channels have a lot of similarities, like, you know, talking about your life with video games, and I think that's really appealing. But what I'm currently playing, I've been playing a Crazy Taxi. I'm about to start up Star Fox Adventures. I was playing a little bit of TMNT on the NES, and that's about it. I was playing a lot earlier in the month, but
You playing Crazy Taxi on? You playing Crazy Taxi is on Dreamcast, the PS2, or what system you playing it on?
Oh, I'm playing it on GameCube and Dreamcast. I'm comparing the two of them because those are the two that I have.
Oh, you're going to do a comparison? So you're going to collab that together and do like a video off of that?
Well, there's going to be a part in the video where I compare the two of them, like the graphics on both of them, but it's just a little section of them. The main meat of the video is just the review of all of the games in the series, like the one on Game Boy Advance, the one on Xbox, you know, the sequel on Dreamcast, and just all of those, and the arcade game.
Yeah, hold on. Give me a sec. Yeah, I try to keep the channel at a position where I'm very transparent, like you were saying, just to dip back to what you were saying earlier about Happy Console Gamer. And I don't know, man, it's funny, because like I said, that's what I pretty much had emulated my styles after. like, especially when I was starting out, or actually when I started to branch out of just doing the pickup videos, I started getting to a position where I said, you know what? I don't know, for some reason, I think it was, I can't even remember which video it was, but I think just in the midst of always talking about where I was at, what was happening in my life, what was going on with me with each video game that I would talk about, then it got to a point where I just started opening up about my life and being transparent. And there was a lot of things that people didn't know about me and didn't understand, and so I felt like the channel became the platform to do that, you know, and I think that's why I say that I don't think you're going to be the same person as you are now versus 3-4 years from now. Cause even myself, I was the same way. Like, I mean, I'm grown, I'm 37. So it, I mean, even for me, like 5 years ago versus who I am now, because of the channel, you start to evolve as a person, you start to grow. And so it's like, you may start off shy and timid, and I still find myself, just because I am an introvert, I still find myself being sometimes intimidated when I go to game conferences or game conventions or whatever. But for the most part, it's, the channel has helped me to branch out of myself a little bit more and step out a little bit more, because I think without the channel, I probably would have been still closed off, like extremely closed off. I'm a little bit more in the position to take a gamble now. Like, I'm able to step out a little bit more, because I know my high school days, I definitely was very close and stuff like that. But yeah, I think with the channel, it's helped out. And that's why I tell people all the time, as much as they think it, some people may think it's too much to talk about your own life. And then some people, they find it therapeutic. You know, they find that, oh, it's like a release. I get to talk about whatever I'm frustrated about or whatever I'm upset about. And so I think that's where a lot of the people that come to the channel, to my channel, to watch it, to view or whatever, my videos, they start to find some sort of common ground, or they may find out things about me that they didn't know, and then they might find that interesting and stuff like that. So yeah, man, it's been quite a ride. You know, and that's why I don't mind showing my ups and downs, like when I'm having a good day or a bad day. Like even that video I did, talking about my last video, but I'll be back. And it was just my frustrations with YouTube. And I found a lot of other YouTubers that I've talked with, and they've kind of gone through the same thing. And that's why most of them, they would take a break, and they won't even say nothing about it. They'll just take a break from doing videos. And they won't even say nothing about it. It'll be like 2-3 months before they drop a video. But yeah, man, I'll tell you this, that over time, you will begin to see yourself stretching out more, wanting to do more. And I don't know, it's a weird thing to explain, but it definitely takes you to different places. But yeah, I definitely learned a lot. Like, I watched his channel years before I even started my channel. And so I just found it so fascinating that he was able to just retain all this information and talk about these video games on such a level. And I was like, wow, this is actually pretty interesting. And then when one of my buddies, he mentioned to me that you should start a channel. And I was looking like, what? Start a channel? I was like, dude, I don't even know where to start. I just took one of my little flip cameras. I had a flip video camera, and it was very basic, and everything was very basic at that time. So even if you go back and look at the old videos, like I was saying earlier, you go back and look at the old videos, it's good. It's a good thing, because then you get to look at your progress and like, versus what I'm doing now, you know. And most times when I'm sitting here editing videos, it's almost an easy process. It's not really that hard anymore. You get it. You know what you need to do. You know how to edit, how to chop up the video, how to make it look or present it in a way. All I'm doing pretty much at this point is just learning new tricks with video clips, graphics, and stuff like that to make it look a little bit more polished. So I'm actually working on getting a new microphone. Hopefully I get one in the next month or so. Then that way everything will sound a little bit more crisp, clear, because I got more people asking to be a part of their podcast. So I know I got to stay fresh. That's all.
Yeah, I think your microphone that you're using right now, it sounds fine. It's definitely not as bad as the first microphone I used. On the old channel I had, I used to do Minecraft videos that were like parodies of Minecraft Let's Players. They were really, really bad, but that kind of added to the charm to them. But I had this terrible microphone, and the camera that I was using for that old channel, yeah, it was a little flip cam. I'd get the flip cam, and I'd start talking about, like, you know, Cowboy Bebop or some anime like that, which I know you're not big into that kind of thing, but yeah, that's what I've been really passionate about on that channel, and I still am. But I had this one camera that I had for years. It used VHS-C, and I could not figure out how to get it on the computer, so I just used the little
oh my god.
I don't know, but I just got the flip cam for like $50 at Walmart, and I'm like, okay, this can work. So I never got
you don't realize how it looks or nor how it sounds until you start having better products. You like when I went from I think this is like my fourth or my fifth camera that I have now, and one of the cameras that I had, it worked out really well. I mean, this is after the flip camera, that little flip camera, and it just was one little lens, and you had to sit it up and prop it a certain way. Then I went to this one camera, and it worked really well, and I was like, man, I love this camera, and then it died on me. So then I started using my phone. My phone output on this one phone, it worked out really well, but then that died. And then the next camera I started using, it was bad. Like, the resolution was bad. So those last 50 videos before, or 20 to, yeah, about 50 videos before I started using my brand new camera that I have, you can clearly see the difference. People made comments on the video. They were like, is that carpet fuzz? Is that dust? Or I don't know. I mean, like, if you go back and look at probably about 4 months ago, 4 or 5 months ago, some of those videos just look so bad. And I was like, how am I getting subscribers off of this crap? And it's just like, but you know what? Really, that's just a testament to tell you that people like your content that much that they're willing to ride with you through some of your bad times. And then when I got the new camera, it just changed everything. Everybody was like, whoa. It was like, yeah, because your old videos look like a 70s porn video. I was like, yeah, I know. It looked bad. So you, because it looked like you had like that grease and oil all on your lens. And man, if you go back and look at a video, I'm like, oh my God. Even the video that Happy Console Gamer recommended, and I think it was Who Will Get Your Collection. Yeah. Great topic, great subject, great delivery, but the visual is awful. I look fuzzy and it looks bad. It was
visuals in that video. It's just some of your older ones that I'm like, okay, this looks pretty.
Yeah, and that's what I'm saying. And I got people that will never. And that's the thing, you have to get an audience around you or a viewership of people around you. Subscribers or whatever you want to call them, that's going to be honest with you. Like, it may only boil down to maybe a handful of people that's going to get to that point with you, that's going to be real with you and be honest with you and just tell you, okay, there's this that you can do better and this that you can do better. And I always try to stay in a position too, as well, as that never feel like you are bigger than what you are. Always make sure that you continue to see yourself as who you are, even when things do get bigger. Like, say if I pick up 5,000 subscribers tomorrow, you know, that'd be a miracle. But if I pick up 5,000 subscribers tomorrow, you should still remain the same person as you were when you had 100 subscribers, or 1,000, or 2,000, or 5,000, or 10,000. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I think with a lot of YouTubers, you know, they get to this point where they're like 400,000 subscribers or whatever, and they get such an ego, and, you know, They say, oh, anything I can do is golden. So, you know, they get so full of themselves and they start doing all these clickbait videos, which there's one particular channel I can think of that I'm not going to name that has done that, you know, a long hair type of guy.
You're right, buddy. Yeah.
But, yeah, I think people get so full of themselves. And to quote one of Happy Console Gamer's video, if you solve world hunger, that's when you get an ego. But video games on the internet, not so much.
Yeah, yeah. And I know exactly what you're talking about. I mean, I can name several YouTubers that done that shit. They'll, and it's almost like, they get to a point, like you're saying, they get to a point where they lose the essentials. They just do whatever because they know at this point, whatever I do, people are going to watch it. And that's a whole different position to be in. Hell, I've seen people with 75 to 80,000 subscribers do that because at this point, their videos are generating 5 to 10K per video. So they're just like, okay, whatever I decide to do, however long I decide to do it, it's not a big deal. Meanwhile, people down here where I'm at, they got to hustle and try to keep, you know, keep that fan base rolling, keep people coming back and watching the channel. So it was pretty cool because when I took that break, and this just lets me know what kind of person Happy Console Gamer is. When I took that break from YouTube, actually I had already, when I did that last video, I had already been on break 2 weeks prior to that. So really I took like a month and something for a break. But Happy Console Gamer reached out to me, and he let me know, like, he sent me a message, and he was like, he said, your videos are profound. You tap into a different subject, and, you know, the way you deliver your videos is great. We don't need to lose that out of the gaming community. So I thought that was pretty cool that he reached out. You know, I had plenty of buddies, friends, YouTuber buddies, gamer buddies and stuff like that, online buddies, reach out. Had a whole bunch of people reach out, and it just let me know that we all make our contribution to the gaming community. Whether you think you're on a small platform, a big platform, or somewhere in the middle, or whatever the case is, we all make a contribution. So we're all playing a role. And that's why I wish I encourage people. And I watch, and that's the thing about me. I'm not this big YouTuber. I don't have all these subscribers. So I don't ever look at one channel and go, oh, this person only got 10 subscribers. I ain't going to deal with them. I watch the smallest channels. I watch the biggest channels. I got buddies that barely got 50 subscribers, and I watch their content regularly. Just because it's somebody has to support you because somebody was supporting me when I had 50 subscribers. You know, and I was happy to get... Yeah, I was happy to get one comment. I was like, what? I got a comment? Man, I didn't even know all that. I was like, man, I still remember to this day the first, like one of the first comments that I ever got. It was from my buddy. I think he lived in Ireland. His name is Spice and Bites. He's changed his name now to like PSB the thing or whatever. Yeah, yeah. He was like the first person to comment on my video. And he's been subbed to my channel 4 year period span and beyond. And I was like, at first I didn't even know. I was like, man, do I got like a stalker or something? But he was the only person really commenting, and he would comment on every video. And I was like, and look, and the crazy thing was, I think when I reached about 400 or 500 subscribers, I had just found out he had a channel. And I was like, dude, why you never told me you had a channel? And he was like, oh, he said it wasn't even about that, man. He said, I just like watching your videos. Because some people come to my channel, and that's the first thing they'll do. They'll be like, oh, I like your content. Will you watch my videos? And some people, I don't mind that, you know, because I will watch. But some people are like, will you sub to my channel? And I'm like, I get that through Twitter and Facebook and YouTube. People will hit me up, and they'll be like, will you sub to my channel? And I'm like, you don't even know if I like your type of style or like your delivery. You know, I watch a lot of videos, so, you know. But, yeah, I think the point I'm just basically making is just continue to stay humble, man, because it's going to come. You're going to have you're going to have videos that's going to blow up. And then, like I was saying on the video that I did about highs and lows, then you're going to have the video that don't do anything. Like, I had a video I put a lot of work in, a lot of time in, and it barely did anything. And then a video where I'm just barely talking about anything, it does really well. So you never know. You never know. So I just tell people, just stay focused on it, man. If you really want to do this thing, stay in it. Hook up with the right people. Reach out to the right folks. You know, if you need encouragement, direction, all that other stuff. But yeah, me right now, what I'm actually been playing, I've been playing Sleeping Dogs. I actually haven't been playing much of my retro stuff in a while. It's just that I've been so busy. My life is like crazy busy right now, getting ready to move. So I don't, like, the weekends, I have too many events to go to, weddings, family reunions, parties and stuff like that with other friends. So that's when I would normally play my retro stuff, on the weekend, but I really haven't had much time. By the time Sunday comes, I'm so tired that I don't even really want to do nothing. But yeah, that's pretty much what my life has been like right now. It's just the last few months getting ready to move, getting all my stuff together, figuring out where we're going to live at, and found a place and all that. So, yeah. Hold on real quick. I had to pull this. All right, so what do you, okay, so with the, do you have any of the current platforms?
No, I don't have PS4 yet. I don't have Xbox One yet. I don't have PC, or I have a PC, obviously, but it's, like, not a very good one. It's supposed to be running XP, but I'm running Windows 7, barely. Because, you know, when I started out my channel, I had this really, really crappy microphone. You know, I had, like I said earlier, VHS-C, and until I upgraded to the number one flip cam. And then I... So I had stuff like that. So I'm still using the same PC. So I don't really have anything that's exactly current gen other than the 3DS, which I absolutely love. But, current gen of gaming just isn't enticing me. It isn't exciting me. No Man's Sky is the only game that I got genuinely excited about. Like, pretty much anything that's coming out, I'm just kind of numb to it, and I go back to the stuff that's on the PS4, the Super Nintendo, or stuff like that.
So that's what you have. Okay, so you got the latest system you have is a PS2, or besides the 3DS? So you got the PS2 and then the Super Nintendo?
Oh, I don't have a Super Nintendo yet. I play that on emulation. But the latest system I have is a PS3. Other than the 3DS.
Yeah. I was going to say, man, you're not in a bad position, you know, because when people ask me, when they ask me my honest opinion about the current gen, I just tell them straight up, just like you were saying, there's really nothing appealing right now. I mean, there's a few little games that I get razzled and dazzled by, but I think they jumped the boat. I think they jumped the gun too soon. But I know how it is with these companies, with these gaming companies and developers and stuff like that. It's like, we got the latest technology that can produce, better resolution, output, make games look better. But because of consoles have a certain limitation. So when you've already maxed out on those consoles, you can only go so far. But honestly, right now, I get little trickles here and there with the PS4 that just make me go, ooh, this looks really nice. Like, ooh, this is a really good game. But I would say to somebody who's enjoying where they're at right now with their console or consoles or whatever they have, stay where you're at. There's really nothing appealing at this moment. Not, like, super fascinating. I mean, there's a few games that I've played that I thought, oh, this is really good. Like, I just beat Uncharted 4. That's probably going to be the standard right now until another game comes along and beats that. But right now on the PS4, that is the standard. That game, visually, combat-wise, story-wise, visuals, everything is just on par. It's a really good game. But, I mean, there's really not much else. Everything else is remasters, renditions of whatever other game that... Yeah, so it's like you already had that on the PS3 or you already had that on the 360. So you're remastering what we already just played. So it's not really like... Now, if it's a game that you didn't get to play on last gen, that's a whole different thing. But most of this stuff that's coming out is remasters. So you're really not losing anything. You're not missing out on much. You're not. I promise you. It looks appealing from a distance. Like, whoa, you know, this looks really good. But then reality is, and I'm telling you straight up, the reality is I'm more appealed to the indie world. So I'm more appealed to the indie titles just because it takes me back to the retro era. And so I see, because right now, let's see, I got the PlayStation 4, PS2, and then I go back to the old stuff like the Nintendo, Super Nintendo, Nintendo 64, the 360, Retron 5. I'm working on getting another PlayStation 3, and I actually even been considering getting a Wii U because I saw one really cheap. I saw one damn near half the price. I think I saw it for like $140. So I thought about getting that. But yeah, man, honestly, there's not much going on. It's not really, really much going on. But yeah, man, I would say to you, high school, because you're in high school right now? Was this your last year, or you finished, or what?
Oh, I'm just starting out, man.
Oh, man, Guppy. Woo, that's the... So this is actually going to be your first year.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. I remember that year. That's... God. So that means I'm about... almost 25 years older. But it's a good time, though, because I will say that I was in that same position as you. Like I was saying, there is so much that I can relate to. One, and it's almost like you're not even really conscious of all the time that you want to spend by yourself. You just do it naturally. Like, there was plenty of weekends that I was at the house, and I was living with my grandmother because my mom had already left. So my grandmother, she had took me in, and she just, I think she got used to the idea. At first, she was not with the concept of me being in the house so much. She was like, what is this? But like, what was weird though is on Saturday, I would go out, but I would go out by myself though. I would go to get my haircut, go to the movies, go to the mall. You know, do my shopping or whatever and buy games or buy clothes or whatever. But I did it all by myself. And I spent the whole entire day by myself. And it was just like, after a while, it just kind of became routine. You know, that just became a part of my life. But as I got older, I started to break away from it. But I still find it to where I spend several hours by myself. So that part of me just never really changed. I think the thing is too, people see me on these YouTube videos and they think that my personality is like this, like real big and larger than life. And it's like, no, I try to give people the realness and tell them like, no, it's really not like that. I'm really kind of quiet into myself. Now there are days where I do pop out of the box and I'm like over the top, but there are days where I'm just like, not today. Really don't even feel like talking or being bothered. But I'm slowly coming out of that. And just think about it. I'm close to my 40s and I'm still like that. So I've just come to the realization that that's just my personality.
Yeah. It took me quite a while from the time I've been alive to figure that out. You know, there's sometimes when I'm getting a call from somebody. I only hang out with a couple people. Like, I have three really good friends that I trust very much, and those are the people I hang out with, nobody else. But you know, I'll be getting a phone call, and I'll just let it ring. I won't answer it. Like, I don't want to, I don't want to turn the phone off.
Engage in conversation.
Be rude. Yeah, I'll just let the thing ring, you know, because I just don't want to talk to anybody right now.
Yep. I do the same thing. I just be like, unless it's somebody I really want to talk to. But yeah, I'm the same way. I only have, to this day, only have two friends that I like. I got one buddy, one dude I call like my buddy, but I got two dudes that I call like my friends. Like, these are dudes that I might go out with, kick it with, might go to one. And it's almost like I use them both for different purposes. I use one to go out to games, go find games, talk about games and music and stuff like that, and we go to game conventions together. Then the other dude, he like my out night homeboy. We might go to bars, we might go to sports events. Like, we're going to the football game coming up. We just went to a baseball game together. I told him, I said, we need to go to a hockey game. Went to a basketball game this year as well. So he's like my sports buddy, and then you got my game buddy over here. But yeah, I really don't bother with a lot of people. And I got other buddies and stuff like that, female buddies, male buddies and stuff like that. And I see them maybe once every 2 months or something like that. So I don't really call them friends. I don't use that word so loosely, because I'm really tight-knit. Like, I only let so many people in. Like you said, there's a trust. There's a level of trust that I only open up to so many people anyway. So, really, I just don't. I don't do that. It's just not my style. So yeah, that part makes it harder for my channel to grow. And so what I've been doing this year is collaborating with more people. I actually reached out to Cannot Be Tamed, the chick Pam or whatever. I reached out to her because she endorses my channel a lot. And so I need to reach out to her and do a collab. And now I'm starting to do a podcast, and I'm trying to do a podcast like every other week with a few other channels and stuff like that. And so that's why when you reached out, I was like, regardless of where you're at, as far as your level, your channel, I wanted to get that out, because it's good to keep that going for me. Because if I'm the type of person, if I stop doing something after a while, I won't stay in that realm of doing it. Like, I'll get away from it, and then things will just fizzle out, and then I'll be like, because I did an interview. I've done several interviews, and I've done several podcasts with other people, but it would be so spread out. So I told this one guy that I work with, or that I collab with, Game for Days or whatever, I told him, I said, man, we need to try to do this, you know, at least once every other week or something. You know, and I said, just hit me up, man, because I want to keep things fresh. And collabing with other channels is very, very important. But, yeah, you'll find that you'll start to get better at this thing. And, you know, it'll all make sense to you after a while. So it just takes time. That's all it really is. But me, right now, just been playing. Go ahead.
Oh, I was just saying, yeah.
Oh, yeah. So, for me right now, all I've been playing is a little bit of Sleeping Dogs. I'm trying to finish that up. Just finished up Uncharted 4. I've been playing a little bit of Hotline Miami, Axiom Verge, and God of War on the Vita. But, yeah, that's pretty much all I've been doing. I said, man, I'm going to try to get back into my retro stuff. That's really what it's been. That's been the tougher thing. Like I was saying, I've just been so busy. My life. As you get older, things get busier. My son will be. That's why I was laughing. I was like, oh, my God. Because I saw your. You know what was so funny, too, is that when you first started liking some of my videos, I was like, who is this young dude liking all my videos? I was like, so let me talk to this cat. Let me see what this dude is about. Because the thing is, when people start reaching out to me, I go look up their stuff. I go watch some of their stuff, and I said, hey, who is this little dude over here reaching out and liking all my videos? I mean, like, I was like, oh, okay, because I'd have had, man, I'm going to tell you, I've had good experiences, and I've had really weird-ass experiences on my channel. And some people have kind of said some really crazy things to me. Like, I told this one dude, I told him, oh, it's good to have you back on my channel. Like, you know, because he started commenting again. He's like, he said, no, I watch all your videos, Life Spiller. I said, oh, okay. I said, oh, okay. I've had some people say some really weird shit to me, and I just, what I do is, most times I don't even respond to it, I just delete the comment, because I just like, oh, okay, yeah. But man, you would think, I guess the thing is, we don't think about what our channel means to somebody else. Like, we just think we're doing videos, we're putting it out, people are, you know, they're commenting, they're reaching out to you and stuff. But some people are like, man, when is your next video? Because this has been too long. I'm like, I'm working on the next video. You know, I think that's probably, I've had people say stuff to me, and it's like, I've had people reach out to me and want my number and want to call and want to talk. And I'm talking about like a hookup. And I'm like, no, I'm married. It's like, I've had people make comments about my wife. You know, some people are, you know, they're respectful. And then I've had people say, yeah, you know, your wife is hot. She's like a porn star. I was like, get off my channel. What the fuck is wrong with you, man? Don't come over here saying that shit. I was like, this is so level, dude. I didn't even acknowledge the comment. I just deleted it. I was like, I'm not even going to respond to this. And then somebody told me, you know, I don't have people tell me some crazy stuff before. So I was like, I said, man, people, I don't know, man, it's just weird. So you just be prepared if you haven't gotten a comment, and then don't step on people's toes about something they're very passionate about. Like, I, you know, I put the video out about No Man's Sky, and I've had people tell me, you're an idiot, what is wrong with you? You can't also, you know what it is? You just don't really like video games. That's what it is. I was like, I had to tell this one dude, I said, man, first of all, I've been playing games for 30 years. I know what I like and what I don't like. And I was like, that's why I put this video out purposely. I really hope No Man's Sky is good. I put that out there, and I told people that I just got an eerie feeling about it. I mean, it may come out, and it's going to blow your mind. It's probably going to blow my mind out the water. And we're going to be like, man, this is like the greatest things ever. But it could turn out to be a flop, you know, and that's what we have to, that's what I'm saying, stay where you at with your current gen, because, or, you know, PS3, the last gen, 7th gen, or whatever, because honestly, I'm going to tell you this, man, I was more impressed with the PS3 and the 360 than I am with the PS4 and Xbox One. At this point, right now, I'm more impressed with those systems. Now, when the VR comes out, and I'm going to get the VR. I'm not going to get it day one or anything, but I am going to get it. And I am going to get the PS4 Neo or whatever it's going to be called, because I'm a type of person, I like to be in the know. I like to know what's happening in the gaming world and how far technology has expanded itself and where we're going next and stuff like that. So I'm getting those things. Even though I said all that about it not being like the ideal system to get at this precise moment, I'm still going to get those things down the road. I mean, that's just how I am anyway. I like technology. I love video games. So it's always a passion. But yeah, be ready. Be ready for some weird people. I've had people tell me, like you said, you had the 3DS. I had the 3DS when it first came out. And this one lady, she went on a long rant. I didn't even expect this. And it was on my video, the 3DS versus the PS Vita. This lady went off on me. She's like, what's wrong with you? You a big ass kid. You're like, you supposed to be a grown man. What's wrong with you playing a 3DS? You need to grow up and get a life. I was like, why are you watching this video if you don't even like video games? I was like, why would you come over here and trash somebody? And this was like my first, like almost my first year in YouTube. So I was like, part of me didn't even know how to respond, and part of me didn't even know how to handle that. But over the years, like I said, I've had some people say some really crazy stuff to me, and I was like, I mean, I've had people search me on all of my LS. Like, this one dude, He used to follow me everywhere. Facebook, Twitter, YouTube. And I started using other websites, and he would follow me on that site too and like everything that I did. And I was like, oh, okay. I mean, and he would always be the first person to do it. And I was like, I don't have no problem with people doing that. I mean, it promotes the channel, but it was just, yeah, it was kind of eerie. So, like I said, just be ready for it, because it's going to happen. But yeah, man, what's going to happen too that's pretty unique is that, you know, your voice is being heard or your videos are being seen when bigger channels start to reach out to you, like the Game Chasers. They reached out to me. System Cycle reached out to me. Casey the Game Nerd reached out to me. Of course, Happy Console Gamer reached out. And it's just like, oh, okay, people are really watching. You know, this stuff is really getting across YouTube. I was like, because at first you just think, oh, only the people that subscribe and a few people that come randomly and view your stuff. No, people are watching. So when you think even the level where your channel is at, when you think people are not watching, people are watching. Somebody's watching, somebody big, somebody small, somebody in between. Somebody is watching your stuff. And you just think, oh, nobody's really watching this stuff, man. I'm just posting videos, getting so many views per video. But let me ask you, what is the one thing that you would like to do with your channel that you can't do right now?
Oh, boy. Let's see. Now, I can think of a couple things.
It could be more than one. Yeah, that's what I was going to say. It's probably more than one.
The first thing that, since my computer isn't very good and it can't run the Elgato that my my auntie so graciously bought for me, which I was really, really appreciative of that, but it can't run that, so I'm not able to really capture much game footage unless I film the TV, which actually looks pretty good, or, you know, if I use a cheaper device that will work, or, you know, whatever. So, capturing game footage is one. And the other one would kind of go into that would be live streaming. Because I've done some streams on my channel. I held the webcam up to my 3DS and I streamed some Metroid Prime Blast Ball. I had a lot of fun doing that. But if I could actually stream using... you know, a capture card on some of my systems, I think that would be really, really fun, and I'd love doing that. So,
yeah.
Other than maybe, like, doing some better writing in the future, because I'm not, like, the best writer right now, over time when I improve, you know, doing better writing, you know, doing more kind of Let's Play type things, you know, with captured game footage, just things like that.
Yeah, that's the big thing for me right now, is that I don't really have all this recording devices, so a lot of the stuff I pull it off of my PlayStation, because it automatically captures it for me, which I would say that's probably the one big thing, you know, that I do like to be able to, you know, I really didn't chat, you know, because like I said, I'm such a private guy. I didn't start chatting with people online until, like, last year. And, you know, online has been around, God, almost 10 years now. Or actually, it has been around 10 years. Where you've been, actually, beyond that, you've been able to chat online with people. And to much of people's surprise, I really didn't start chatting online with folks until last year. I was never in that realm. I was never in that space where I just felt like I needed that. I don't know. I just didn't see the point nor the purpose. I was like you said, I don't really get into that. Now, some people have learned to get with me, like you said, through Skype or Google Hangout or chat on the PlayStation or whatever. That's how they end up catching me, and that's how I end up joining groups and stuff like that and being a part of all those things. But yeah, really chatting online is just a new feature for me. But The big thing that I want to do with my channel is just the graphics and stuff like that. Like, I want my videos to be a little bit more polished and stuff like that. And that's really what, if it's one thing, that's my big thing right now, is being able to be in that position to just do better quality videos. I mean, they're good. I always tell people this. My videos are good enough for the level that I'm on right now. But if I'm taking my channel to a different place, because that's the one thing I don't mind doing is asking for help. So I even reach out to YouTubers and I ask them, I'm like, hey, how do you do this? Or how did you do that? Or how did you make this pop up on your screen and stuff like that? Oh, I did this, and that. And most times it's just a few steps, nothing big, you know. But yeah, you have any other questions for me?
Yeah, I got, I lost the paper here. That's how unprofessional this podcast usually is. let's see. What are some games you love that most people in the YouTube scene seem to hate?
Well, first of all, the God of War. If I dip back, like, a lot of people didn't like God of War 3. They had their gripes about it, whatever. I mean, they personally did not care for the game, but a big game that's, like, from the retro era was, like, Super Mario Bros. 2. A lot of people deem that game not a sequel. They look at it like, because it was originally a Japanese game, but it got brought over here to the States. And the reason why I like that, what's that?
Oh, I said it was dope.
Oh, yeah, I thought you said. Yeah, exactly. And so a lot of people didn't like it because of that transition that it went through when it came over here. But I liked it because it had multiple players on there where you could choose from. And you could choose them on any stage, anytime you wanted to. So when I would die, I could just change from Mario to Luigi to Princess to Toadstool. And I loved each character for different purposes. And so that was one of the big games that I got into that I noticed that a lot of people didn't give a lot of love, or they didn't care too much for it. And it's actually one of my favorite games that a lot of people don't really care for. But God of War, if we go back to your gen where you're at, that one, a lot of people didn't like that because they just felt like it was the same stuff, even though the scale of the games have changed and stuff like that. You were able to do, you know, big boss battles. It's easily one of my favorite games. I think another title where somebody else didn't really, or people didn't really care for it. The one I actually just did a video on, Astro Boy, a lot of people didn't like that game. You know, it got pushed to the wayside because a lot of people just, it got bad reviews. But I actually enjoyed that title. I actually really loved that title. I've actually played through it twice already. Now, the first time I played through it, I got to the very end, but I never beat the boss because it gets stupid hard at the end. I don't know what the hell they do with the difficulty level, man. It got dumb hard. So then the first time I never actually finished it, but the second time I got to the end again and I actually beat it. I'm trying to think of another title that didn't really get all this love, because I done picked up some new stuff too. I've been picking up a lot of old stuff and new stuff. What's that PS1 game that I picked up?
Soul Suspect.
What's that?
Soul Suspect.
Oh, you said Soul. Yeah, Murder Soul Suspect or whatever it's titled. That one actually was a really good title. You know what? Honestly, I did not like it on the PS3. I was actually one who even went along with the crowd, or the majority, I should say, and trashed the game. Like, the mechanics on it was broken. It was glitchy as hell. It was a lot of shit that just did not work. But when I got it on the PS4, it was like a new game. I couldn't even, like, the first time I played it on the PS3, I could barely get through certain parts of the game. And when I got it on the PS4, it felt like I was playing a whole new game. And to this day, man, it's definitely one of my favorites that I got to play. It would probably be in my top 30 or something like that, or top 40. But, yeah, man, I actually really, really enjoyed that title. Had a lot of fun with that one. And I recommend that to people all the time. I'm trying to think of some titles that didn't get love. And that's what I've been working on, is like, that's what I want to base my reviews around, is titles that didn't get a lot of love and they kind of got pushed to the back, versus the common titles. You know, like, common titles to me is like 1943 or DuckTales or the Marios, the Mega Mans. Those are common titles. Castlevania stuff, all that stuff is so common, and most of those games don't, you know, they don't get a lot of they don't get any hate or anything like that. Even if they're mediocre, and they still get a lot of love regardless. But yeah, those are like some of the titles that I can remember that a lot of people didn't just fall head over heels in love with. And I think that's where I'm at with the No Man's Sky. In the beginning, I was in love with the title, but I think over the last year or so, it's kind of changed for me, because they're just not telling me a lot. Some people have found that it factor for them, like, ooh, you know what, when they talked about this, that was it. That was enough for me to say, I want this game. And some people have not changed their position on it. I watched like an hour gameplay from the developer, and he just didn't give me enough. It was like he was the worst salesman, so I was not thrilled with it. I did not find that game appealing. Another title that's a throwback that a lot of people didn't love was Judge Dredd on the Super Nintendo. It's actually a really good game. It's based off of the movie Judge Dredd with Sylvester Stallone and Wesley Snipes. Or no, that was Demolition Man. But this one is... go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say that was Demolition Man.
Yeah, and a lot of people didn't like that title. They didn't like the actual game, or the video game. I sat through that game, and like we were saying earlier about just spending so much time by yourself, man, I beat that game in like 2 days over the weekend when I was, shit, probably about your age. I think I was like 15 or 16 at the time, and I beat that game in like a few days. I went right through it. I didn't, you know, unlimited amount of time to just play video games at that time, and so I just went through that like it was nothing. I'm trying to see, is there any titles that I have that just stand out? I got a lot of crap, and then I got a lot of good games, and then I got some weird type stuff over here.
Yeah, I try to fill my collection with stuff I like. Like, I don't have any room for bad games. I don't have enough money to be buying bad games, so I just try to always buy something, okay, I know I'm gonna like this. Or sometimes I'll get an oddball, like, you know, okay, this is a little weird, but I usually end up liking it. But back to what you were gonna say about No Man's Sky, it's a really intriguing idea, and I think that's really advanced what they're doing with it, but I think that that game could get kind of monotonous, as advanced as it is. Because how much they can only do so much with the randomly generated worlds. So that's just my perspective on that.
Yeah, and it's supposed to have like 18 trillion planets.
Quintillion
or some really absurd number. And then it's been like a little bit of back and forth about the size of the game. The first time I heard the size of the game, they said it was going to be 6 gigs. And so I was like, well, how is that going to work out? You know, because most of these games they're like 40, 50 gigs or something ridiculous.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, you'll definitely be able to generate this game and run it on your system. It's not going to be no big deal, but on your laptop or computer or whatever. But I don't know. I still don't know what to think about the game. I'd rather... So I'm at a position where I was like, you know what? I'm going to let all my buddies get it. They say they're going to get it. I'm going to let the reviews come out. And I really don't pay too much attention to reviews because reviews are so-so to me. They're so finicky. I just don't even really pay too much attention to it. I mean, I hear them talk about it. Now, if it's old retro stuff, then that's when I might pay attention to a recommendation or a review or something like that. But the newer stuff, I don't really pay them no mind. I listen to word of mouth. Word of mouth is usually the best seller anyway. So I told people, I said, man, just come back to me and hit me up and let me know what you think about the game. And some people already told me they're going to do a review on the game. And they'll give me their perspective of how they feel about it. But some really, really good titles that I've gone back and played like numerous times. Numerous times, like it's ridiculous. Vice City, Mega Man 2, Castlevania 1. What else is there? Ninja Gaiden, which whatever you want to call it. Life Force on the NES is a really good title, good shooter.
Yes, it is.
Adventure Island. Yeah, that's a good game. It's got a little challenge to it, but it's not too bad. Like you're saying, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. The first one.
And the weird,
I also picked up the second one.
Oh, I was going to say, the weird thing about TMNT1 is so many people hate that game, but I just absolutely love it. Like, people like to complain about the submarine level, but...
Yeah.
I haven't had that much trouble with that level. You have... For me, I only had to do it 3 times, and I was done with it. And, you know, the turtles that I was using, when I was switching back and forth from them, kind of like Super Mario Brothers 2, I didn't really have that much of a problem with that level. And when you're through the rest of the level, it definitely is pretty difficult, but it feels rewarding to me, so... I think that's a really good game right there.
Well, you definitely got further than I did because I didn't get that far on the game. I remember playing that. I think I played that level probably at a friend's house or something like that. I don't remember getting that far myself. But, yeah, I got that one, and then I got the arcade one. That's pretty good. A few titles that I found over the years that I didn't even know existed on the Nintendo was Section Z. It's actually a pretty good, I guess it's like a little bit of a shmup shooter type game. I think it's pronounced Gyrus or something like that. That's actually another good shooter. I discovered that on the emulator. Gyrus, thank you. I found that on my emulator on my PSP one day. And then I found the game, the physical game, the actual cartridge or whatever, about a year ago. And... that game is actually pretty good. I was surprised how good it is. And I was like, man, people probably don't even know about this darn game, but it's actually really, really good. And, I mean, of course, Nintendo got its common titles and stuff, but what were you trying to say?
Oh, I said I love it.
Yeah, it's actually, that's the thing. If you just really... dedicate a day to just playing like retro, like if you got your mindset in that position where you like, okay, this is what I'm going to play, this is what I'm going to get into. And a game that a title that I found that not a lot of people, I see some people talk about it, but not a lot of people talk about it, but it's a Sega Genesis title, and it's actually one of my favorites. It just takes me back to the beginning of the Sega Genesis. It's called Green Dog, that beach surfer dude. This is a really, really good side-scroller, and I'm a big fan. Have you played it?
I came so close to buying that game, but I was so unsure about it. It was on JJ Games.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, it was on JJ Games for like $2, but I didn't buy it because I didn't have the money at the time. Oh, man.
Tell you what, man, just send me your information. So you haven't got it yet. You haven't got it yet, right?
No.
Okay, tell you what. Just send me your information, and I'll send one to you. I got two copies. I'll send you one.
Oh,
it's a really good game. I'm like, yeah, it's a really good game for real, man. I love that game. I actually, I used to play that game all the time, and it takes me back to a really good era. I mean, it's only, I think it's got like 15, 20 stages on it. I can't remember. But it's a really, really good title. I'm not even, and I'm going to tell you this, how much I love that game. Besides the point, because the thing is, I'm not really this big Sega Genesis fan. I'm more of a Super Nintendo fan. I just like the way things felt on the Sega. Now, there are some titles, some obscure titles, like, wow, you really had fun with this, like Golden Axe, Strider, the original Mortal Kombat, Aladdin. I like the, you know, Sonics, the Sonic 1 and 2. I didn't really get into Sonic 3, but, oh, and the Revenge of Shinobi, Toki, the Ape Spitting, or Going Ape Spit. There's a ton of titles on the Sega Genesis that are actually really good. I just never got around to a lot of them until I got older. Now, I don't know if you played a game called Vector Man. You need to play that if you haven't.
I played it on the emulator. I came close to buying it, but I just didn't have the money at the time. It's a
Vector
really
Man
good
1
game,
is really good.
Especially Part 2.
Yeah, yeah. You know, that's the thing. Sega Genesis kind of tapped into their own area, and they had some really quality titles. And a lot of those titles just kind of got overlooked. A lot of people know about them, but, you know, people just didn't go out and race out and buy those games. But, yeah, what else? Let's see. I'm a big Raiden fan. So all those shooters with Raiden in it, I love those games. I used to play mine on my TurboGrafx-16. That was a really good game. Some games that I picked up on the Super Nintendo over the year that I never got a chance to play, that I was glad I got, Maximum Carnage. That game really is good. Batman Returns, that's a really good title. Speedy Gonzalez for the SNES.
That's
a really good title.
Oh, that's me, actually.
Yeah, it. Have you played it?
No, I haven't played it yet. I saw it when I was looking through a different eBay searches of, like, how much Super Nintendo games were worth back when I used to really, really want one. But I saw that game, and I was like, oh, this has got to be bad. But,
Yeah, it's actually good. I got that one recommended. Yeah, it came recommended at a game convention. At a retro game convention, and somebody told me, man, you need to get this title. Because I've been trying to look for, you know, like you said, quality titles out of each console. And just have that alone in my collection. Finally picked up Tenchu for the PlayStation. I picked up Part 2. I've been looking for that for a long time. But it just kept coming recommended. It's like, man, you should play that game. Man, you should play that game. And now, every time I try to find it, I couldn't find it. I just couldn't find it. But, yeah, man, I can tell you about a lot of games. At one point, I think I had about 700 games. And so,
wow.
I'm always looking to get rid of, at one point. I got rid of a lot, man. I got rid of 200, then, you know, I turn around and buy about 20 here and
what
10
it,
here.
Like,
before you know it.
What was it, like a
what's that?
Shelf full of nothing but just Madden?
Oh, no. It was a lot of games. Like, my PS2 collection at one point, I had, like, 200 games. I was like, whoa, this is getting crazy. And then the Nintendo, I had almost 100 titles. I was like, okay. But then that's when I started to filter out a lot of the stuff that I realistically said to myself, I'm probably never going to play. So I started getting rid of a lot of stuff. A game that surprised me, well, it actually isn't a surprise. It's actually a really good game. That one gets tossed about a lot, so I'm not even going to mention it. It's a common title. Let's see. I'm trying to look for one that I actually found interesting that not a lot of people talk about. Acnoid is actually pretty good. I used to play that at the arcade, so it was a good title. What is this? Arknoid, thank you. Mystic Ninja. I don't know if you've ever played that, but you need to play that game. You probably better play it on the emulator, because it's expensive. I think it's like $40 now. $35, $40. It's expensive. Yeah, Super Metroid is another good game. What's that?
I thought it was called, like, Wrath of the Mystical Ninja or Rise of the Mystical Ninja or something. Maybe I'm thinking of a different game. Is it on the Magic?
It's on the Super Nintendo.
Oh.
No. This one I'm talking about is on the Nintendo. Mystic Ninja. That one's a really good title. And I almost picked it up one day for $30, like 2 years ago. I'm kicking myself now because I should have went ahead and got it, because it actually turned out to be really good. A game that I actually found a few years ago, Rogue Galaxy. It's a really good. If you're in RPGs, you need to play that. Like, it's really, really good, and it stands the test of time. Like, it still holds up. It looks really good. Let's see.
I think my dad used to have that game before he sold all of our PS2 games in order to get the 360. But going back to the Mystic Ninja game, isn't that Goemon?
I'm not 100%. You might have it up on me. I don't know. But yeah, it's a pretty interesting title. I wouldn't pay too much for it, but it's actually really good. I had a lot of fun with that one. I would get the, what was that? What was the other game? Oh, Rygar. I liked it on the NES, PlayStation 2. The PlayStation 2 version is a 3D version. I've talked about it on the channel before, and it's a really good game. It's a really, really good game. Let's see.
Yeah, the first way I heard about Rygar was there was this guy on YouTube dressed up like a Viking or something. He was reviewing, I don't remember what his name was for the life of me, but it was like from 2009 or 2008, around that really weird kind of era in YouTube.
It was this guy dressed up
as like a cross between a Viking and a pirate or something, reviewing Rygar, talking about how horrible the controls were or whatever, and like yelling about it.
Yeah, you have to get used to that. Yeah, you had to get used to that. And that was just, and like you were saying about the angry video game nerd, there was some people that I've seen try to do his style of being kind of like doing the negative reviews, like games they hate or whatever. But it's like, if you're going to do it, you got to do it right. You know, you got to be able to put a spin on it and, you know, make it your own. I mean, I guess they say imitation is the best form of flattery or whatever. But yeah, that's pretty much it for me, man. As far as the titles and stuff like that, I played a great deal of games, so I guess that's why I know what I like and what I don't like, and you know, I spent so much time with being in that position of playing video games. All right, did you have any other questions?
Oh, I was just going to say about the whole angry video game nerd thing. The reason why a lot of those channels that were popping up back then fell flat was because they weren't really doing what he was doing right. Like, they didn't put their own spin on it. They were just completely taking what he was doing, and they weren't even doing it, like, to where it had the same appeal. Like, they tried that basic idea, but the thing about the AVGN was he brings back that kind of nostalgia of getting mad at these different games, and he was talking about games from his childhood, and he was really bringing you back to that time, even if you didn't grow up in that time, and he did it so well. But with a lot of these people that were just imitating it, they were taking the swearing, they were taking the angriness, and they were just reviewing bad games for the sake of reviewing bad games. So it didn't have that same appeal, so I don't understand how they got so popular back then. But, you know, the reason why he was angry with his character is because he felt privileged to tell gamers about these bad games. So, you know, they just took the angriness of his character and just kind of made everything fall flat in my mind.
Yeah, yeah. It's something else to watch people try to do that. And like you said, then you also have to think about the quality, because he's got a background in cinematography and stuff like that. So he's pretty good at that. He's good at, like, I even look at his videos now and I'm like, the stuff he was doing back then was really good, and the stuff he's doing now is even better. You know, I wish he still would do some of the angry reviews, but that just takes so much time, and I think he's working on another movie, so he's really been devoting a lot of time to that. But yeah, so he's working on another movie. So yeah, it's, I don't know, man. I watch some of these channels, and some of them just become so somewhat of the same thing, and so I just have to filter through all of the stuff that sound the same, look the same, act the same, and I think that's what's been keeping me here so long, is watching what people were doing and then realizing, what did I need to do to stand out? And you see all these channels start up and then they go away. And then some people, they'll start out strong and then they fizzle out. And, you know, I've thought about stopping myself a time or two. And then, you know, after a while, the channel becomes a part of you. And as far as, like, you start to get used to doing it. You know, it's like it becomes a part of your routine. Like I record a few times a week. I edit a few times a week. I upload a few times a week. Sometimes I'll do three times if I'm up to it. But for the most part, I try to do two videos a week, you know, and try to keep them. I try to release them on decent days that I know people will watch based off of the numbers that I generate on certain days and stuff like that. So, but, yeah, I love what I do and I'm enjoying it. But like I always say, when I get to a point where I'm not, then I won't do it anymore.
Yeah. There have been a couple times when I was doing YouTube where I just needed to take a break from it, but that hasn't happened too much because I ended up having to take breaks anyway because I had to work on, you know, school a lot. And I really had to focus on that. And, you know, maybe there's just some other things in the mix. But, you know, right now, I get up and I work on a video. And there are some days where I just work on videos the whole day. I look at the clock, I'm like, wow, I had no idea it was this time. But I've just been having so much fun here making videos and thinking about, you know, all these ideas that I'm going to do for these videos. And, you know, for like 5 days straight, not too long ago, I just got up, worked on videos. It was late, went to sleep. The next day, I got up, worked on videos because I have a lot of time on my hands. And, you know, other days, things are going kind of slow. It just depends on what my mood is. But I have a lot of fun doing it. And it's just part of my routine. Sometimes I do it more than others. And, you know, sometimes I'll work on it once a week, and others, like, I'll work on it 5 days straight.
Yeah, I just enjoy it. No, I'm just gonna say that's it. I just enjoy it.
Yeah, it's definitely a lot of fun, and the only other thing that I could ask here, where do you think YouTube is going? This is a nice question to end on.
Well, I think YouTube is going. Realistically, I think they're going to do a big wipe off. You know, as far as, I think there's going to be a time where they're going to cut some people off. They're going to get rid of some channels, and you're just going to have. And I think they're just going to. I think, and it's just based off of what I've been seeing, some things here and there. But if we look at it on the positive side, I think if we want to look at it on the positive side, I would say YouTube is heading in the direction where it could really work out to your benefit to be on YouTube as far as producing videos, putting out content and stuff like that, because I see YouTube basically becoming TV. I would say I watch more of YouTube than I do of TV. I find myself streaming a lot more. You know what I'm saying? I stream way more than I used to. Yeah, I see, like I said, if we stay in that positive realm or that positive area, I definitely see YouTube becoming full circle, where people are just becoming fully stuck on YouTube. That's why they invented YouTube Red. Now they got people paying. People are literally paying for content so they can watch paid for content on YouTube. Because YouTube has always been free for yourself. That was their slogan when they first came out. YouTube, I think it said free for yourself or free for yourself or something like that. I forgot what it's called. But basically, it was just getting at being free. And if you notice, too, all platforms, TV, music, they're all turning towards, and movies, they're all turning towards YouTube. This is where we go to for trailers. This is where we go to listen to snippets of new songs or listen to an album in entirety. Or we want to watch a TV show. You know, we can catch it on YouTube. Movies, you can watch it on YouTube. Everything now is in that direction. So where do I think YouTube is going? Probably in the next 5-10 years, I think it's going to be in its full circle. It's going to be everywhere. It's going to be easier to stream. Like, I didn't even think I would be watching YouTube on my TV. I thought it was always going to be on my computer. But then eventually, they provided an app for your phone. They provided an app for your TV. I mean, now I can watch it wherever I go. So it makes it easier. Now, on the other side of things of YouTube, I see them taking a big broom and wiping a lot of these channels. Like, I think they're going to give us a certain time to reach a certain plateau. And if you're not constantly uploading content, they're going to wipe your channel off. They are. I just see them doing that. Because even now, they put a cap on people's space of where their video is seen sometimes. It's a weird thing to explain. I don't even think I'm explaining it right or well or whatever. But I think there's going to be some changes. I think they're eventually going to move everybody over to where you're going to have your content paid for. You know, if you're not on YouTube Red, you're going to eventually get rid of YouTube, the free side, as far as just having all access and having it all free and everything. There are some changes that I've been seeing, but, you know, I don't know. So what do you think is going?
If that did happen, I think that other services where you could put your videos on and monetize them would start rising up. But the thing about that is it would be kind of hard to get all these audience to move over there. There'd be some people who wouldn't go over, even though they're spending all this money. But if a free service, you know, kind of showed up, I think a lot of people would go over there if everything you start having to pay for everything. I think videos are gonna start getting longer because, like you said, it's becoming more like TV. So people aren't just looking for these, you know, 5-minute to 10-minute time waster kind of videos that they can just watch. Like, you know, Xander Scullion is a good example of that. I go on his channel and he's like 5 minutes or 6 minutes of video. And I'm like, you know, I want more minutes of this because you know, it goes away so quickly, and his videos are so good. But there's so much other stuff, it really doesn't even matter. But I feel like for some people, they're going to want longer videos. And I think videos, podcasts, whatever you see on YouTube, it's going to be getting longer for some people. And I think as you make that transition to it being more like TV, there's going to be more of that. Other things, you know, YouTube has this whole creator studios set up around the United States. So you could go to one of these places and you could work on content, which I think is pretty cool. You know, they got this whole creator hub coming out to help you work on stuff. I don't even know where that's going to go, but I don't know.
Yeah.
My thoughts are kind of scattered on it because I'm just, there's just so much that goes into it because, you pretty much just said everything I was going to say.
Well, yeah, because I was thinking myself that, see, we have like an age gap, so your generation is the generation to come, or they're already here, I should say. So you guys are the next YouTube. I'm the old YouTube.
Yeah.
You know, and so a lot of the stuff is so weird because sometimes I'll, you know, that's why some of my videos have been shorter, just because of the attention span of people. Like I said, I'm going to try to keep my videos in the 5-minute realm or whatever, but it depends on the subject. If it's a big subject, then I will expand and go beyond that and do longer. And it's so weird because some people will tell me they want longer videos. Some people tell me they want shorter videos. Some people say they want more videos. Some people, you know, it's like, you're going to get a cross between a lot of things, and trying to find that area where it's going to work is a whole different thing. But yeah, I think YouTube is heading in a good place. I think it's not always going to work out for the little man. I think they got a lot going for them, and that's why they invented the YouTube Red. And a lot of people were opposed to the idea initially. They were like, what, paying $10 a month or $9.99 or whatever you want to get me with? But at this point, that subscription fee thing is working, and a lot of people are signing up for it. So I know that I myself, I got to build a certain fan base to where I'll start doing videos, long videos and stuff like that, because not everybody has your attention span. You know, some people are really tap out and they'll be like, oh, about 4 minutes, I'm done. Or, but see, when I watch videos, I usually watch them to the end. I've watched videos that are 20, 30 minutes long and I'll watch them to the end. It's just, but that's just my attention span. It's like that. But yeah, YouTube. I was gonna say YouTube is heading in a weird place. It's kind of a mixture of things. They don't tell you everything, but yeah, you're right. They do have the creator space where they do try to help you out, and you got a few people that reach out to you every now and then. And sometimes they'll post a little survey thing on your video manager or wherever on your channel, basically asking you a list of questions. How do you feel about YouTube? Do you think it's benefiting you? Do you think they're helping you out and stuff like that? So, but yeah, I always try to get, I always try to get the mindset of you guys, the younger generation, how do y'all feel about YouTube? So what were you going to say?
Oh, I was going to say, I feel like they just put those surveys there and they don't really do anything with them, because you know, I think what YouTube really cares about is, you know, what's going to make the money, and small channels aren't going to make the money. It's the big channels, you know, PewDiePie, Markiplier, people like that, that people want to see for some reason. So I think we're more focused on that. I mean, the game theorists have their own, like, YouTube Red show where you can only see it on YouTube Red. So I think they're going to focus on, you know, people like that, like PewDiePie.
That's why I'm saying that's why I'm getting at the whole idea of wiping off certain channels. Like if you just got an active channel with no content on it, like you only produce so much, I think they'll keep people that's consistent with their their output of their videos. And these people are, if they see that this channel is steadily making growth every week, they're gaining videos, views, subscribers, or whatnot every week, they look like they're growing somewhere. But if your growth is stagnant, and you really not making an impact, I think they're going to start wiping you off. Because that's streaming. It costs them to stream you on their channel, on their website, I should say. So that's why I'm getting at. And I even see how they do some of these videos. Like, they help some of these channels when they release their video, what tags to use, what day to use it, what time to release their videos and stuff like that. And that's why the big channels just get bigger and bigger. Whereas the small channel, we just crawling. Because I'll get subs here and there, and then I won't get no subs for a few days. And then I'll get some subs, and I won't get none. And I'll get some, and I won't get none. I remember there was one point. I remember I was at one point at 700 subscribers for almost a year. Like, in that realm, between 700 and 799 for like a year, almost. And it was, and I was putting out all kinds of content and everything, and I was just like trying to figure out what is going on. But, yeah, it was just like that.
Yeah, what I was going to say was, I don't pay attention to the analytics. I don't pay attention to I do pay attention to how many views I'm getting, but I don't usually pay attention to much of that. What I usually just pay attention to is making content I'm going to like and making content that I'm going to enjoy making. I don't usually spend a lot of time paying attention to the analytics except, okay, this video's getting this many views. Here's why I think why it's getting this many views because, well, I did this and this and this. Okay, maybe this has a factor in why this is getting so many views. But I only do that so much. I don't like to pay attention to the analytics. What I really like to pay attention to is getting better. And that's why my channel, I guess, hasn't really grown that much because I'm not a huge numbers freak on the analytics. So I always just focus on making videos I could enjoy and that I think other people could enjoy. So I never really paid too much attention to that. And, you know, like you're saying, that if you're not making a video each week, they'll get rid of you. I think maybe what people might do to get around that is they'll put up like a 2-minute video saying, oh, you have to watch this in the title. And it's just going to be them saying, hi, you know, I'm only making this video so my channel doesn't get taken down. I'll have the regular content that you come here for, you know, next week. You know, see ya.
Yeah.
I think some people might get around that system that you think they may have in place by doing that. That'd be kind of interesting.
Yeah, yeah. And I think, you know, it's a good headspace to be in, that position that you're in, because then that keeps you going. When you don't care too much about all the other stuff and you're just doing it because you're having fun and you're enjoying it, that's a good reason to keep doing the channel. Because at this point, I don't really get too caught up with the subscribers like I used to. Like I wouldn't lie, I used to obsess about that. And I don't really obsess about the views as much anymore. I just look at, is my channel making growth? That's all I really start focusing on. Am I going somewhere with this channel? Because there's going to be videos I put out, and they're going to do wonderful. And then there's videos I put out, and it's like pushing a boulder up a hill, just steady growing. And you don't see immediate things happen. And I've had videos that didn't do nothing for months, and then they just take off, and they just, somebody got a hold of it, and somebody else watched it, and somebody else watched it, and then all of a sudden, it did several thousand views, and it was just like out of nowhere. Because I look at my view count every now and then, and I'll be like, I said, people are still watching, you know, like even days that I'm not dropping content, people are still watching. They're watching old stuff, new stuff, or people that just discovered me, they're watching stuff. And they discovered me on their own, or they may discover me through a shout out or a mention or whatever, and it just starts happening. I've, like, one of my videos that started off slow was my GTA collection. I did my GTA collection, and I have almost a complete collection of GTA games from the beginning, PS1, all the way up to now. on the PS4. And I got all, like, all games in between. And that game, that video was starting out real slow and didn't do much the first few months. Like, the fifth or sixth month, all of a sudden it started getting all these views. And I was like, where is this coming from? Like, and then it got to a point where I think it did over 1,000. And then got close to almost 2,000. And I was like, I didn't even expect it. So your content does whatever it does. There is no formula. Don't let nobody tell you there's a formula to making great videos. There really isn't. I mean, you can have the best equipment and you can still... I got buddies who got 10,000 subscribers and they only do like 100 views a video or 200 views a video. So it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. It's just love what you do, man. Enjoy it. Put it out there. Have fun with it. That's, I always say to do that, especially in the first few years, man, you definitely got to get that because that's really your learning time anyway. So, you know, but
yeah,
that's it for me.
Yeah, thanks for coming on the podcast, Life Spiller. I really appreciate having you on here. I was a little nervous when I first came on because, like, you know, I was kind of, you know, shaking because I still am. I'm a big fan of your videos, so I was just
cool.
I was kind of nervous having you on.
No, there is nothing to be nervous about because I get like that with other people, and I'm like, I don't even know why. Like, when I first met Billy from the Game Chasers, because they live in my neighborhood. Like, they live in my, I'd say backyard, but the first few times that I met Billy and Jay, I was like, blah, 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 blah. And then the next few times I met them, I was like, then the next time I met them, I was like, hey. And then next time I say, hey, man, what's going on? He's like, oh, nothing, man. And I was like, I got over it. I was like, oh, okay, yeah. And that's why I try to tell people all the time, because I've had a few people reach out, and they were like, you know, can we meet you? And I was like, man, if you see me, just say hi. I'm not going, not no big deal to me. But, yeah, I was like that. And this year, a lot of people are coming down to Retropalooza, like Metal Jesus, he's coming down. Gangster, he's coming down. The Game Historian, he's coming down. A lot of their buddies is coming down, basically. I was like, dang, I wish Happy Console get, man, if he come down, I'm gonna turn into a little kid. I ain't even gonna lie. I don't care. I'll be like, man, I've been watching that dude for 8 years. So if I see him, I'll probably be like, I remember when I met, he haven't dropped content in a long time, but I remember when I met Machine Game Texas. He used to drop content all the time. He used to drop some really good stuff, but he's been in school and all kinds of stuff. And when I met him, I was like, he was shouting me out. He was like, Life Spiller, man, what's going on? I was like, he's like, yeah, man, I watch this stuff all the time. And I was like, what's up? So I guess it's funny to me when you look at people a certain way and they already just like, hey, man, it's just a regular situation, man. There's really no difference. I'm just putting content on a form. That's it. So that's all it is. But yeah, I just enjoy what I do and I love it. But man, I'm finna get ready to go on here and get me something to eat. And if you ain't got nothing else and you don't have no other questions, man, I'll be looking out and I'll just hit you up, like I said, about your address and just send me and tell me where to send the game to, and whenever I get time, I'll send it to you.
Cool. Yeah, that's pretty much all I had planned to talk about. So,
okay.
Once again, thanks for coming on.
All right, man. It's no problem at all. I'll holler at you. Bye.